So let my life be the proof of your love. Let my love look like you and what you made.
The pure, unadulterated Word of God. And for that, they killed him. Wow. And so the persecution happened, and it continued. So people began to leave Jerusalem, believers. But as they went, they kept speaking, preaching the gospel. You see? And that's what was happening. And then now the gospel is going to the Gentiles, and it's like, oh my goodness, here we go. And so then God began to use Peter, the mighty apostle Peter, and a Roman centurion. And he brought them together, and as one in the church, both trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ. They were members of the same society, the same group, the new group called the people of God. And now it's called the church. And it's expanding, right? And with that expansion comes all kinds of tensions and difficulties. But that's what we find here at the end of chapter 11 of the book of Acts. So here's how I would summarize verses 18 through 30. In spite of difficulties, each believer is to be participating in the work of the church. In spite of difficulties, each believer is to be participating in the work of the church. Let me read the passage, and this is how I break it down. Verses 19 through 21, the continuing gospel spread and difficulties. That's what it shows. Verses 19 through 21, the gospel continues to spread, but there's all kinds of difficulties. And then verse 22 to 26, the right men for the right job. The right men for the right job. And that's where you and I are going to come in, and the application is going to be right smack on us. Okay? 22 to 26. Then 27 to 30, the desired results. And what's the desired results? Sound Christian growth. That's what we have. Sound Christian growth. So let me read the passage, and so as I read it, you can kind of, okay, break it down the same. And brothers and sisters, that's not an inspired breakdown, okay? This is just to try and get a handle of what the text is saying. So after you read it, you might want to break it out in a different way. That's okay. You know, I'm just trying to understand it. So here we go. Remember, Peter had already testified, and there was a tension whether they should keep the Old Testament law or not. And so, no, they were convinced Gentiles who had not been circumcised, they were not even under the Mosaic law, they were being saved. It's like, how can that happen? Well, it happened, and Peter showed them, and so they accepted that. Now, this is within Judea, with Jerusalem, within Israel. But now, the gospel is expanding hundreds of miles away from Israel. And so now the tensions come, right? So now we pick it up in verse 19. So then those who were scattered because of the persecution that occurred in connection with Stephen, remember the martyr, made their way to Phoenicia in Cyprus and Antioch. They were along the coast and then the island of Cyprus and all the way up to Antioch in Syria. There's another Antioch further north, but this is in Syria at that time. Antioch speaking the word to no one except Jews alone. Okay, so that was one group. It was, hey, only the Jews, right? Because they're the people of God. Verse 20. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who came to Antioch and began speaking to the Greeks also, preaching the Lord Jesus Christ. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. The news about them reached the ears of the church. That's a funny way to put it, and I'll see, tell you why. The ears of the church, okay? At Jerusalem. And they sent Barnabas off to Antioch. Then when he arrived and witnessed the grace of God, he rejoiced and began encouraging them all with resolute heart to remain true to the Lord. For he was a good man and full of the Holy Spirit and faith. And considerable numbers were brought to the Lord. And he left for Tarsus to look for Saul, who was Paul. Verse 26. And when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. And for an entire year, they met with the church and taught considerable numbers. And the disciples were first called. Agabus stood up and began to indicate by the Spirit that there would certainly be a great famine all over the world. And this took place in the reign of Claudius, and I'll say about him, and in the proportion that any of the disciples had means, each of them determined to send a contribution to the relief of the brethren living in Judea. And this they did, sending it in charge of Barnabas and Saul to the elders. The work of God, the work of the church. God has given us the church. God has given the church to the world because the world is in darkness and there's salvation. And God has commissioned the church to carry that message and to help people out of darkness into the light. And that means you and me. We're all commissioned to help in that. I have to start off with saying, do you care? Because many of us may be just caring about, well, my marriage is not good. My car's not working right. I don't know about my job. I don't know about my health. I don't know about my family. Oh, I don't know. And here we go, you see. And those are not necessarily bad things, right? We are responsible and we need to. But that's not the most important thing that God has us here on earth for, you see. And we have to be realigned, well, God, what is God up to? God is up to using you and me to share the gospel, to share the good news of Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ is the one and only means of salvation, the one and only means to get out of the darkness into the light, you see, to really, really help people. So that's what he has us here for. But we live in full of tensions, right? Full of problems. But in the midst of those problems, we are to keep participating in the work of the church. So here we go then. Go back to the tensions and difficulties. Verse 19 mentions the persecution, right? That Stephen had gotten martyred. And then you have the issue there that those who were being scattered, they were carrying the gospel, but only to Jews. Only to Jews. Not good. They were preaching the gospel, but there was a mentality, hey, these are the people of God and only the people of God. But now we find in verse 20, but there were some from men from Cyprus and Cyrene. Cyprus is an island off in the Mediterranean. Cyrene, listen to this, Cyrene is very, very close to present day Benghazi in Libya. Okay? That means that Cyrene is like 600 to 700 miles away from Israel. What's the point? The gospel has been spreading now and is going beyond the borders of Israel. You see? And that's the point. Now, some of those men from Cyprus and Cyrene came to Antioch. Antioch was north. Let me say a few things about Antioch because in this passage, it's just very important. I'm going to tell you four things about Antioch. Number one, Antioch is mentioned 6 times in this passage, more than any other passage in the New Testament. What does that tell you? Something is important about Antioch. That's what it tells you. 6 times is mentioned in this passage. In 64 BC, that is 64 years before Jesus Christ was born, Antioch became the capital of the province of Syria. And the province of Syria was a province of the Roman Empire at that point. But it was the capital of the province of Syria, the Roman province of Syria. Which, by the way, right now it's on the southeast corner of Turkey. That's where it is now. So that's how much the gospel had gone up further north. And so these people, 600-700 miles the other direction, came all the way to Antioch to preach the gospel to Greeks, it says. Now, here's a third thing about Antioch. Antioch at that point was the third largest city in the whole empire, the whole Roman Empire. Alexandria and Rome were the two biggest. But Antioch was the third. It was a huge city in those times, right? So here's the fourth thing, but this four things is very important because this is
use a lot. How about that worship? How corrupt was that?
And so that whole area, and there were Romans and Greeks and all kinds of people in Antioch, right? And that's where the gospel was being preached, you see? So you can imagine the tension. Okay, now these are Greeks, and they're not under the Old Testament law, and they're becoming believers. And you have this worldliness, this ungodliness. You have idolatry. You have all kinds of problems in Antioch. And it's a cosmopolitan area where many different cultures are joining in. And that's the deal, you see. So when you read it, it's like, okay, the person who was going, people were just preaching to the Jews. But no. There's these other Christians saying, wait a minute. Let's go to Antioch. And they preached the gospel there. And what does it say? They were preaching the Lord Jesus Christ, verse 21. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. They were having great success. Non-Jews, non-law-keeping people. The Lord was bringing, was saving them. But you wanted to know something. Where it says, they believed, they turned to the Lord. That means there was a source of, a sense of repentance, a sense of I'm leaving behind this worldliness, this idolatry, this moral laxness, this moral looseness. I'm leaving it behind. There was a change of character. That's the point. You see? It wasn't that they were just becoming believers. And you have to know that, because then what follows becomes, you know, okay, here's the key. Here's what's going on. So the issue of law, no law, the issue of worldliness versus godliness was there, and the church was growing, all right? So those are the difficulties. Law, no law, and worldliness. And that's going to create a lot of tension. So God says, we need to put the right people in there, right? The right men for the right job. And so verse 22, now the news about them, what is it? The news that these Greeks, these non-Jewish people who were not under the law, they were coming to the Lord, they were being saved. When it reached the ears of the church, meaning as soon as they heard the news, like, oh, we got to do something about this. We got to do something about this. Is this orthodox? Is this right teaching? Is it going to go off in the wrong direction? And so, man, right away, as soon as the news came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, they sent Barnabas off to Antioch. Let's send this guy. Why Barnabas? Remember the meaning of the word Barnabas? Encourager. And he was full of the Holy Spirit. You got to send the right person, man, to deal with the situation. So right away, the church says, man, is this good or not? They send Barnabas right away. As soon as the news came to the ears of the church. Then they went, when he arrived and witnessed the grace of God, he rejoiced. He was a Jew, and he saw people that had not been keeping the law. They were not under the law, and they were coming to be saved. Was he concerned? He rejoiced, man. He saw the grace of God. Yes! Yes! But he also was realistic, because look at what the text says. He saw the grace and he rejoiced and began to encourage them. This is what he was known for, to encourage people. What was he encouraging them to do? Now the text there is kind of ambiguous, so let me just bring it out to you, because he's with all a resolute of heart to remain true to the Lord. Does that mean that Barnabas was the one that resolute of heart? Or he was telling the believers, hey, with resolute heart, with purpose, be true to the Lord. And that's the meaning of it. In other words, Barnabas knew the culture, and he knew all the different gods that were being worshipped and all the different temptations for the believers. And he was telling them, listen, brothers and sisters, have a clear purpose in your life. Have a clear motivation from your soul. man, there's all kinds of temptations, all kinds of freebies that are being offered only to hook us into buying. Stay resolute, man. Young people, listen. It's hard for you. It's hard for you because so many things are being offered to you that have nothing to do with the kingdom of God. And it's so easy to give in. Barnabas saw, man, what was happening, and he was saying, guys, single purpose, remain true to the Lord Jesus Christ in the midst of these problems. For he knew, he himself was very clear, right? Because look, verse 24. For he was a good man, and full of the Holy Spirit, and of faith. And when that was happening, a considerable number were being brought to the Lord. A considerable number being brought to the Lord. Now, what happens when an organization grows? So do the number of problems. That's what happens. And Barnabas was like, man, there's 100 there, 100 there. Oh, another 100 there. I can't do this. I need help. Because, man, there's all these tensions. All these people coming to know, and then there's going to be tension with those that are not keeping the law, those that are keeping the law, and then worldliness. I need somebody, man, that's got some backbone. I need somebody that's got knowledge. Saul, Paul, let's go get him. So what does the next verse say? He left for Tarsus, man. I got to go find this guy. I got to go find him. That's what it says there. Verse 25, and he left for Tarsus to seek for Saul. Why Saul? You know, the conversion, right? He came to know the Lord, and what was happening after he converted? He was unstoppable. He was absolutely fearless. They tried to kill him twice. Didn't matter. He kept preaching. He kept debating. He said, come on, bring it on. Bring it on. Like, this guy, that's the guy I need. So he went all the way to Tarsus. Tarsus was several hundred miles north, further north. Where is this guy? Where is he hiding? I gotta come ahead. So that's what he did. And when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. There it is again. And for an entire year, they met with the church and taught considerable numbers. And the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. What's the point? The point is now, there's now a separation more from Judaism, from Jerusalem, you see? Now it's not no longer a, this is just a subgroup of Judaism. No. This is something very different, you see? For the first time they were called Christians. Now with that problem, with that came several problems. I'll just mention one. One is, the Romans had said, had determined, had decided that Judaism was a legal religion. It was acceptable. And so because of that, the Romans didn't mess with them. But now, if it's a very different, it's not acceptable. You see? So now this church is being called now Christians. It's not Judaism. The Romans are going to come and persecute. That's the danger. We're going to find that later on. In fact, the Christians were burned at the stake. I mean, history shows it's an amazing thing. But here we have, so Paul and Barnabas were together working with this new group that was growing by leaps and bounds. You see, and Barnabas knew better. I can't do it alone. So he went to go get Saul, and they taught for a whole year, and they were called Christians for the first time. Now, what's the result of all this? That there's tension, but you got the right men for the right job, and the Holy Spirit's at work. You know what happens? You have good results. You have good, sound growth in the church. It's not a popularity type of a growth. It's not a celebrity type of a growth. It's real character-changing growth, where people are really growing. Because then now that's what we find in verse 27 and following. Now, just to make sure, there's a connection still with Jerusalem.
Now at this time, some prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch. One of them, Agabus, stood up and began indicating by the Spirit that there would certainly be a great famine all over the world. And this took place in the reign of Claudius. Claudius was the Roman emperor at the time. And Claudius was, he had a physical problem. And he really didn't want to be emperor because he saw his nephew, I think, get murdered as an emperor. It's like, I don't want that. But, you know, they still put him in as emperor. And during Claudius, there were a number of famines. There were a number of famines during his reign. And somebody pointed them out. There was on the first, on the second, on the fifth, the ninth, and the 11th year of his reign, there were famines. So here, when Luke says, when he puts it in the reign of Claudius, there was a famine. Yep. Now, he reigned from 41 to 54 AD. Jesus was crucified around 33 AD, right? So if he started on 41, that means the church was at least 8 years old. You see? At least 8 years old if the famine occurred on the first year of Claudius. I know I got you confused. All right, never mind. The church was either 8 years old or 19 years old, okay? Take it as that. We can talk about it later. Anyway, that's the point. There, here came this prophet from Jerusalem. He told them, hey, there's going to be a famine. Now, what do you do? You've got tensions of law, no law. Ungodliness, godliness. And now, on top of that, you've got a famine. Now, how will you and I react? How do people react? I mean, if a hurricane is mentioned that it's in the middle of the Atlantic, boom, HEB is emptied. I mean, any little thing, boom, we go nuts. What happened here? With all these difficulties, you think the Christians just became self-protective, selfish? No, look at what happens. Verse 29. And in the proportion that any of the disciples had means, each of them determined to send a contribution for the relief of the brethren in Judea. Oh my goodness. These Christians who had not been under the law, who are now that are Gentiles and now become Christians, now they're supporting the mother church. They're sending money back to Jerusalem, to Judea. See, that's sound Christian growth. You see? I got to protect myself. It's just for me, my family. And here we go. We've got nothing to give to others. You see? But no, these believers, and when it says there, they determined to send. The word there is for like a deacon, a ministry. But this ministry wasn't just a ministry. The indication this was a ministry of love, of real desire to give to others in love. That is sound Christian growth. It's not out of pressure, you see. And then what happens? The right men for the right job. Barnabas and Saul take it to the elders of the church, those that can administer and make sure things are done properly. The right men for the right job. Now take it easy, ladies, not just males. I'll talk about them. So in spite of difficulties in this life, I don't know what difficulty you're going through, and we all have many, many different difficulties. When we are growing properly, we're going to be involved in the church, brothers and sisters. In one way or another, we're going to be involved. That's the point here. But here's my first application. Verse 23, what did Barnabas do? He told them, look, with clear purpose, very clear intentions, live faithfully to the Lord. Live for the Lord and have that predetermined. You have that as very intentional. Don't like, well, I guess I ought to. I'll think about it. Let's see how the week goes. And no. made, I'm going to live for the Lord Jesus Christ. No matter what the problems, it's going to be more important than anything else. That's the first application, you see? Because today, there's all kinds of rationalizations and watered-down versions of the Christian life. Watered-down versions. I'm sorry to say, but I hear many preachers. Me, all right? Let me say that. But I hear so many preachers, well, you know, you got to have the right stories and massage the audience so they listen. Have a conversation with them. Be quiet. Preach the word of God, man. But that's what's happening. We got to, you know, not offend anyone and let's, you know, give them the opioids so they can feel good. No. Watered-down versions of Christianity. And there's all kinds of stripes candy offered for that. You see? No. Have a clear purpose in your heart that you're going to be true to the Lord no matter the difficulties. That's the first application. Second application is not as clear, but it's there. What has been happening in verse 26? Antioch. Antioch, 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 Antioch. No longer just Jerusalem. Jerusalem has sent Barnabas. Jerusalem has sent prophets. But now there's a shift happening. The center of administration, the center of Christianity, so to speak, is shifting, right? And historically, that has happened in the past 2,000 years. Did you know that? Historically, that's what has happened. At one point, of course, it was Jerusalem, the beginning, and then Antioch. At one point, it was, ready for this? It was France. Macron. It was France. And then Germany was the center of Christianity. Can you imagine that? The homeland of Hitler? That was the center of Christianity. At one point, Martin Luther came out of Germany. John Calvin out of France. Another time, it was England. England was sending missionaries, oh my goodness, to China, to men all over the place. Now England, many, many churches, if not most of them, are museums. Yep. At one point, Russia. Russia. Awesome Christianity in Russia. More recently, the United States. Say is, maybe I should say was. We were sending missionaries and money all over the world. Unbelievable. And now other countries are sending missionaries to the United States. Yes. Maybe the spirit is leaving. Maybe the center of Christianity is no longer the U.S. We dare not localize God to some place or some person. I haven't gotten to the application yet. I'm just telling you historically what has happened. You see, the center of Christianity has moved. So here's the application. We must be ready in accepting the major administrations to be relocated. There needs to be a change sometime from the father and mother to the children, right? We get to the age as parents that we just babble and pee on ourselves. We need somebody to take over. And I hope way, way before that. But we need to be accepted. our Holy Spirit guide. And that's very hard to do. Very, very hard to do. So be ready to accept relocation or redistribution of what you thought was the center of Christianity in your own life. Right? It's hard to do. We can talk more about that in sermon discussion if you like. Then finally, my last application is this. I said the right man for the right work, for the right job, right? What part of the church work do you need to be doing? What part of the church work do you need to be doing? You see, here we have what? In this passage, we have what? We have evangelists speaking to the Greeks, right? We have Barnabas encouraging the believers. We have Saul teaching. We have Agabus, the prophet, proclaiming what was coming. We have the disciples providing money for the support of the needy Christians. And then we have the elders making sure that things are done right. And they're all part of it. You know, God has chosen to do it this way. God, not me. God has chosen to do it this way. So I ask the question, what part are you supposed to be doing in the church? Ephesians chapter 4, First Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16 says this. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16. From whom the whole body, meaning the whole church, the whole body of Christ, being fitted and held together, being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies. Maybe I'm the elbow, maybe I'm the toe, but you have to be the arm. You have to be whatever. By what every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. What part of the church should you be involved in? We have identified five different areas in the church. I'm sure there's 1,000, right? But here's five for convenience, for getting our hands around the work of the church. Number one, worship. Maybe you need to be a part of worship. You say, I can't sing, but that's what matters. Can you light candles? You can do many things to kind of change the atmosphere to a more worship, peaceful area where we can worship God. Or maybe you can sing. Maybe play an instrument. Whatever. Buy instruments. Buy what the worship team needs. I don't know. How, can you be a part of the worship? You say, no, Pastor, that's not my area. Okay, I got a few more. Here's another one. Christian education. We have Christian education here in the church. Sunday school, and we're always, always in need of more teachers. You see? Always. Be a part of it, man. And if you lack training, there's plenty of training. We got some people, masters of theology in this audience here. We got several of them. And we can put them to work. Just name it, man. We can help you. You're not Christian. No worship, no Christian. Okay, here's another one. Fellowship. Fellowship, helping people get together. I was telling somebody, you know what? It's been a long time since the church has had a picnic. We need to have a picnic. Well, if I'm going to organize the picnic, you're not going to get a sermon. We need somebody else to be getting people together. Potlucks. I mean, somebody, we're organizing the potlucks. Hey, let's encourage, because that's when people get together. I know it's hard. I know it's hard because everybody has 1,000 million things. Sunday afternoon, never mind the rest of the week. But we need someone to help people get together. You can be a part of that. Host one. Encourage one. Go to the park. Put a picnic. Throw hot dogs. Something. get involved in outreach. We have missionaries. We can write letters. We can encourage one another to do missions, to outreach. We have the young people going to Mazatlan. How can you encourage them? Pray for them. Give them money. What do they need? Be a part of that. And then there's stewardship. Here comes money. Some of you are gifted with making money. And maybe that's the area you need to be most involved with. So, well, I give my 10%, Pastor. Be quiet. Because God has gifted you, and you maybe ought to be giving 30% or more. Maybe not. Maybe you can just give 5%. That's totally fine. Let the Spirit move. Nobody knows. Nobody's going to... You only gave. So I don't know who gives and who doesn't give. I don't care. It's the Holy Spirit that needs to be doing that. All I'm saying, if you have the gift of that, then be a part of the church in that way. You see? But be a part of the church. Why? Because the church is the gift of God to a fallen world that's in darkness, and they need salvation. And God has chosen to use you and me working in the church. Working in the church. Will you? I don't know. I kept telling people, man, I could yell and scream all day long. But until you decide, I can't force you. And I don't want to force you. I want to passionately communicate to you. And I do it out of love, brothers and sisters. Because I see the world. I see so many young people suffering. They would stop